Good evening all. I am Avinash Khanderao. Recently joined my work under Dr. Dilip Kumar at UGC DA Consortium for Scientific Research, Indore. This is the title of my talk. These are the contents of my talk. We will go through the introduction of organic spintronics. The field of organic spintronics get developed after the discovery of the conducting polymers in 1977 by these persons, and this discovery was awarded with the Nobel Prize in 2000. Okay. Why to use organic spintronics? Because it is the best candidate for the future application, because it has a high spin relaxation time, weak hyperfine interaction, it has low manufacturing cost, it is a lightweight, and they have high chemical flexibility. The main applications nowadays you are using in organic spintronics, like OLEDs and plastic electronics, are the best examples for this. Though these have plenty of applications, but these the spintronic devices like spin walls have some preparation challenges. When we deposit an organic material on a metallic substances, we get a sharp interface. But the reverse case is complicated. That is, when we deposit any metal on a polymer, it get diffuses deep into the polymer, which get failure in organic spin walls like structures. Taking these as the motivations, people trying to lower the deposition of above metals in polymer semiconductors. So there some efforts has been done, like evaporation done by electron beam or heating measurement, or low temperature depositions, or taking a barrier layer in between the organic metals and the top electrodes, or one of the best is the glancing angle or oblique angle deposition, so that to get reduce the penetration of the above metal into the soft polymers. Some of the examples of the organic semiconductors are presented here. Out of which, this is the most used fellow in this category, LQ, commonly known as LQ3. It is the organic semiconductor which has low hyperfine interaction and low spin orbit coupling. In our lab, we deposit our polymer film using our lab-made PID control heater, and this is the inside view of our high vacuum chamber. Here we have the electron gun, so that we can deposit a metal on the above metal on the polymer film. For this present study, we have deposited our polymer film using this PID control heater, and the epi film was deposited in our in situ chamber, and the growth and the magnetic properties of the epi film was studied in situ in our versatile chamber, which is accompanied with the in situ facilities of MOOC, XRR read, and resistivity measurements. Okay, these are the real time evolution of MOOC loop during the epi deposition on the LQ3, that is my organic semiconductor molecule. Here you see that the from up to 29 angstrom, we do not get any Kerr signal. That Kerr signal get evolved from about at 30 angstrom and get stable up to at 100 angstrom. This graph shows that the corrosivity variation with the thickness and the Kerr intensity variation with the thickness. Here we get that the corrosivity initially increases and then get saturates after 11 nanometers, whereas the Kerr intensity generally linearly proportional to the thickness of magnetic layer, so it should follow from the origin, but here it cuts at 2 nanometer, that is 20 angstrom here. So it may get possible to the magnetic dead layer at the interface of the polymer and the metal. Okay, in order to further study the temperature behavior of the magnetic properties at the interfaces, we analyze my sample at different temperature. Here are some representative graph at different temperatures taken at. Here we show that the corrosivity get abruptly high beyond 200 degrees Celsius, whereas the Kerr intensity signal get reduced beyond 200 degrees Celsius. This may be due to because at from 200 degrees Celsius, the diffusion of my Fe metals get more and more deep into the polymers, so that the overall contribution in magnetic contribution get reduces here, which is further confirmed by the in situ XRR measurement done in our same chamber. The XRR is at room temperature at 300 degrees Celsius. This is the electron density profile. Here we see that this the blue color curves show graph shows that this portion is the diffuse part of Fe into the LQ3, and at 300 degrees Celsius this portion is increased. So it is clearly significant that at higher and higher temperature my Fe atom go deep and deep into the polymer. Okay. In order to further study the interfacial magnetic behavior, we have take use of this technique, nuclear resonance scattering, available at P01 Petra 3 DAISY. I don't have to take time so much because it already the first talk of this today's lecture have very well explained this technique. In our sample, we have just take the a barrier layer of 57 in between, sandwiched between my polymer and Fe metals, and the as NFS is a depth isotope selective, so it make me study to the interface of metal and organic interfaces. Okay, this is the time spectra correspond to the Fe deposited on silicon, and here we get the hyperfine field of 32 tesla, which is near to the bulk, and the moment orientation at 47 degree out of plane of the film, whereas in case of an Fe deposited on my polymers, we get the reduced hyperfine field up to 28 and 13 tesla. And the interesting thing is the moment orientation is in a film, is in a plane of the film, is due to because of the soft nature of polymer, and Fe spin moments get relaxes in the plane of the film. Here I conclude with this. I get a 20 angstrom of magnetically dead layer due to because of the small initial growth mechanism, and Fe deposit deep into the LQ3 matrix with which this diffusion is increased at higher and higher temperature, and we get with reduced hyperfine field. Thank you.